Artistic Director for Guerrilla Theater Productions. Welcome to our 20th annual Greek Sunrise play. We are happy to be back on the steps. We had to leave for a little while and go across the street. We started back last year, was our first time back on the steps. So we're happy to be back. This is the birthplace of the Greek tragedies at sunrise here. It's become a Kansas City tradition. Thank you very much for coming out this early morning. I apologize for the damp grass. The sprinklers came on about an hour ago while we were setting up. So there's a few people I'd like to thank. I'd like to thank the Native American Indian Center for allowing us to rehearse in their building. I'd also definitely like to thank the Milton Atkins Museum for allowing us to do this for 20 years. I'd also like to thank Have Guns, Will Rent, and of course, Lico Sound Company, Ron Dennis for helping us out at the last minute with costumes. And I'm sure I'm forgetting somebody, but I'll be back after the show. There is no intermission. It's played straight through. There is restrooms across the street where Shakespeare was. And if you get really hot, we have a courtesy tent set up over here so you can kind of get yourself a little shade. So set back. It's about an hour and a half show. And so set back, relax, and there will be a KC stage talk back after the show. So if you'd like to stick around and find out more information about KC stage and talk to me and the director a little bit about the play. I think that's it. So sit back, relax, and enjoy Seven Against Thebes.
Citizens of Thebes, sons of Cadmus, as the man who sets the course for the ship of state and guides its helm with eyes ever watchful against the treachery of sleep, I must say what must be said. We have battled a long time, and should we be successful, the glory will be the gods. But if disaster strikes, gods forbid, one man will be blamed. I, Eteocles, will be cursed from street to street. Eteocles, in loud, swelling chants. From these evils may Zeus protect her, uphold his name, and shield the city of the Cadmeans. Now your task, you green, unripened boys. All of you are sons of Cadmus, and must protect the city and defend the shrines and altars of the native gods, so they are not damaged or dishonored. And you that are past your prime, you must aid too. Protect your children and Mother Earth, your beloved nurse. When you were young and crawled upon her hills and valleys, she raised you to become honest men, to carry a shield and to be worthy of her in her hour of need. And you in the fullness of manhood, hear me now. Until today, the gods have tilted the scales favorably. Though long under siege, the war goes well. Thank the gods. But now, the blind seer Tiresias, herdsman of the birds, expert diviner, using his ears and mind to understand with unerring skill the omen of the birds without sacrificial fire, has prophesied that the Argives are planning to attack and capture our city this very night. Cry havoc! Away then to the battlements and city gates! Make haste, all of you! Fall out in full armor! Swarm the ramparts! Scale the turrets! Stand firm and brave! You need not fear this foreign horde. Zeus will guard you all. I have sent my spy to observe their army, and I am confident that he will soon return. Once I have learned of our spies' report, we will be invulnerable to enemy plots.
See you, please. My lord and noble king, I bring you news of the enemy's army. I was there and saw with my eyes what I report. This very night, I saw seven of their captains slit the throat of a bull over a black iron shield. And dipping their hands into its gore, they swore an oath by the trinity of battle, Ares, Enyo, and the bloodthirsty rout, either to raise the walls and gut the city, or in death, defile this land with their blood. Then they took tokens of themselves over to Adrastus' chariot, mementos for their homes and loved ones in the event of death. They shed tears, but never voiced a groan of no. Courage, that iron-hearted spirit, glowed as of lions with war blazing in their eyes. You will soon hear confirmation of my news. For as I was leaving, they were casting lots to divine against which of our gates each captain would lead his battalions. Therefore, choose our bravest and strongest men, and station them quickly at each gate. Already the army of Argos, fully armed, is advancing in a flurry of dust. White foam flecks the ground with froth from the snorting stallions. Like a steady helmsman, you must secure the city before every storm cloud blasts down upon it. Even now, the wave of their army crashes over dry land. Take fortune by the forelock. I will remain vigilant. I will stand watch day and night to make clear reports of the enemy's moves, so you will stay informed and unharmed.
Well, pays honor to its gods.
Please,
before our gods who shrink their fears and fall upon the ground. Immodest, detestable absurdities! May the gods never suffer me to share my home with one of the tribe called woman. Whether in poverty or prosperity, women, when things go well for them, their arrogance is unbearable. When they are touched by fear, then they are an even greater evil. Your wails and moans, your skittering feet, your cries of fear have spread paralyzing, soulless panic amongst our citizens. To assist the tides that threaten our walls, thus we are being sacked from within. Such is the fate one can expect from living with women. I hear now decree. Anyone who fails to obey my authority, whether man or woman or some sexless thing, a sentence of death will be decreed upon her. Public stoning, a fate that she cannot escape. It is for man to take care of business outside the house. There's no place for a woman. Stay home and cause no trouble. Do you hear me or not? Am I speaking to the dead?
Alas, son of Oedipus, we were terrified.
The thunder of the chariots,
the loud roar of the axles,
the forked iron ringing, the mouth of the horses as they charge.
Tell me, will the sailor leave the stern and run to the prow to find a way of safety for his floundering ship when seas get rough?
No, he would not. When I first heard the murder sound of the war, I rushed in.
God's hands. And it is said the gods will capture the city, abandon it.
I hope these gods will never abandon me while I'm alive.
Nor ever abandon our city to the destructive fire of the enemy.
Try not on heaven in impotent debate. But invoking the gods be well advised. Obedience is the mother of success, life and salvation.
That might be true, but the gods are almighty.
Their light can raise the helpless from their despair.
And lift the heavy, hard clouds from their eyes.
Making sacrifices to the gods and consulting them before a battle is a man's job. Your duty is to remain silent and stay inside the house.
It is to these very gods that we owe our freedom.
It is because of them that our city is not a conquered city.
Why would anyone be angry at us for praising them?
Do not begrudge your honoring the gods, but your lamentations make the citizens timorous. Keep your lips sealed, and do not be overly fearful.
Hearing the clanging of armor and the company of arms,
we, dear women, rush to this holy sanctuary of our city.
The separating confusion sounds of a mating cannon.
If then you hear that men are dying or wounded, do not be eager to anticipate it with loud wailing. Ares, the god of war, feasts upon the blood of men.
I can hear the snorting of their horses.
If you hear them, imagine it's a gentle rain.
The barrier crumbles under siege from the enemy.
That is truly my concern, not yours.
The question at the gate grows louder. It frightens me.
Hold your tongue. Oh, no one hear you say that.
Betray us not! Hold fast our walls!
Damn you! Do you not face your fate in silence?
O gods of our city, do not let my fate be slavery!
It is your shrieks that enslave the whole city!
Oh, mighty Zeus, hurl your weapons upon our foes!
Zeus, the curse you fashioned in creating women.
A curse as miserable as the man of a conquered city.
How dare you speak of defeat while caressing the gods?
My courage has gone from my heart, and fear has control of my tongue.
Let me ask you to grant me a small favor.
Act swiftly, swiftly will I know if I can grant it.
Silence, spineless succubus! It's are wiser than the rest. Now stand away from the statues. Instead of hysterics, offer this simple prayer. May the gods be our allies in this war. First, hear my vow, then offer your victory cheer. Then sing the victory song, the sacred cry of joy and goodwill, our Greek ritual. Make it loud and hearty to raise our men's spirits and strip away from their hearts the fear of battle.
Pitiful it is that women are prized thunder, young and slaughtered.
A thin blood cry of infants fills the air as gore-covered babes unweaned drip blood, and lumbering spearmen pierce each other's bowels.
Pillagers loot each other in plundering brotherhood. Greed joins with greed. Unlucky calls an unlucky, growling discontent with lesser or equal shares.
Boys and maidens flee, but escape not their pursuer. Robber with robber joins, each calls his brother to partake in the feast of hate. When things are like this, how can one watch what happens next and keep one's reasons?
All earth's very fruit poured upon the ground. Bitter sight, sour grief, to see it spoiled and spent. Abundant gifts of the earth, riding the reckless looting waves.
Oh, alas! Young women, enslaved, suffer new evil, a bed of misery. Forces spread for the sweating soldier, ruffian ravisher, the triumphant, battle-inflamed, conquering enemy. Woe, woe for you, young maids. All they can anticipate is meeting their nighttime duty. Perhaps dark deliverance may occur. An aid which gives aid to tears and anguish.
Sisters, look! Is that not our squire returning? He comes in haste, bringing some fresh news.
Sisters, look! The king, son of Oedipus, returns with unaccustomed speed to hear the spies report.
I have learned which gates each captain has won. Give you first-hand knowledge of the Argive plot. Tigis stands opposite the pointed gate, branding, but dare not cross Ismenus' fort.
Why?
The prophet prohibits because the omens of their sacrifice were ominous. Tigis, enraged, thirsts for battle. He berates and taunts the wise seer, Euclides, and accuses him of cringing in cowardice before death and battle. With such thunderous agitations upon his lips, the triple plumes of his helmet, like a horse's mane, do quiver and shake, while at his shield's rim, brazen bells clang and reverberate, terror in their tone. And on this shield, he bears this arrogant device. A night sky ablaze with stars, most intricately crafted. In the center shines the full moon in full brightness. The moon, the most revered of stars, the eye of night. In full armor, he paces the riverbank, shouting for battle like a stallion chomping at the bit, anticipating the trumpet's call to arms. Whom will you send against him? Who will be our champion of the pointed gate?
I am not intimidated by ornamentation. Decorations cannot bite without a spear. When I consider this night sky displayed upon his shield, sparkling with heaven's stars, perhaps the folly will prove prophetic. For if night shine upon his eyes in death, the arrogant blazon will its own truth prove. It is against himself that he is prophesied. Against Tigis, I will post the loyal son of Asticus to defend the gate. A valiant, modest soul who detests braggarts and their proud speeches. He shuns base acts and is untouched by cowardice. A descendant whose Ares himself has honored with life. A true son of this soil. Melanippus, the black horse. Ares, with the toss of the dice, decides the victor. But justice and duty call this man, this hero, to guard his motherland against enemy spears.
May the gods grant good fortune to this one!
adventurous king, stands a giant of a man, Capnus, larger than Tigis, and more arrogant. He shouts all sorts of vile threats at our city, threats which I hope fate would never allow. He boasts he will utterly destroy this city, either with the gods' blessing or without it. If Athena, the maid warrior, swoop to earth and plant herself in his path, he will not be stayed. Not even Zeus, striking with giant slaying lightning, will be an obstacle to his purpose. What is the difference, he asks mockingly, between Zeus' fire and the fire of the midday sun? Note the symbol on his shield. A naked man bearing fire, a flaming torch, blazing in his grasp. And in golden letters, he declares, I will burn this city! Who will face him? Who will stand firm without trembling before his books?
His boast will be our gain, returned with interest. You know, when mortals have foolish ambitions, their own words often betray them. Running off the mouth in folly's ecstasy, regardless of the gods, Capnus threatens action. A mere mortal launches his loud boasts at Zeus. May the gods grant his words and send the true firebearer Zeus's bolt of flame that in no way resembles the sun's midday heat. Against this braggart, this would-be Prometheus, I will station a man of action in few words. A man of fiery spirit. A torch of courage. Mighty Polyphontes.
Oh.
A killer of many. Go forth, dependable sentinel, with heaven's grace in the favor of your champion, Artemis. Victoriously return with these spoils to adorn his father's house.
Academy! One man
take the shower of missiles hurled at them. This warrior means to make a target of himself, attracting most of our weapons to the vanquished man upon his shield. At the Borean gate, he stands. By name, Parthenopeus the Arcadian. I dare say, he hasn't come all this way just to play games with us. No! This warrior will try and get his money's worth for the journey to that battle. That's the sort of man he is. A foreigner who's been living well in Argos with some nobles or other. Now he wants to pay his debt for that hospitality. So he hurls insults and threats at our walls. May Zeus avert these horrors.
May the gods show their hand with violence at all the insolent and arrogant emblems these warriors parade about the place. Let the gods deliver them the ruin they so wish upon us. There's but one man to challenge this Arcadian, this Parthenopeus, the brother of Hyperbius, a humble man, no braggart. This man has skilled hands that will do what is needed instinctively. Actor, he will dam the flow of baseless bragging, denying entry to this seed of mischief, holding back the abhorrent effigy of the ravenous Sphinx. When the heavy hammering blows fall upon her, the beast will blame he who bears her against our wall. With the gods' help, I also may write the answer for riddle.
Tonight,
about men are dangerous. Against him send some wise and brave opponent. The man who reveres the gods is man's fiercest foe.
The last fate. Honest man wants these irreverent wretches. There's no greater evil than bad companionship. For it may be that a righteous man, going on board ship, has embarked with sailors intent on committing some crime, and perishes along with the vessel's detested crew. Or a man, though upright himself, when with fellow citizens who reject those unlike themselves, with hostile behavior towards all strangers and forgetful of the gods, that good man may fall undeserving to the same snare as they, and is subdued by the gods' all-inclusive scourge. This seer, this Amphiarius, priest of Apollo, a man both wise and just, devout and brave, a moderate, noble, reverent man, and a great prophet, but mixes with these impious, rash-talking men against his own judgment. Men who have come too far to turn back now. And if it's Zeus' will, this prophet also must be dragged down in ruin along with them. Now, I do not think he will even charge the gate. Not that he is a coward or weak-willed, no. It is because he knows that he must die in battle. If the prophecies of Apollo were to come to fruition, gods usually either hold silent or speak to the point. Just the same, I will station a man against him. Stand, mighty Lasthenes! In mind, an old man, but a young one in his body's vigor, with his swift swooping charge and his hands undelaying to snatch a spear and hurl it unerringly to strike what is left exposed by the shield. But only the gods can grant success to mortals.
City and move freely in his father's halls.
Such are the symbols, emblems, and inventions affixed to the shields shown by our enemies. And now falls to you. Whom do you send against your brother? I have done my part. You will find no flaws in my reports. You and you alone must decide the course of this city, as is your privilege by law.
Cursed house! God-hated house of Oedipus, drenched in tears, my house. This is it! Finally, my father's curses are to be fulfilled. Neither weeping nor wailing, lest it breed greater grief. As for you, dear brother, so fittingly named Polynices, I found answers to the riddles of the other shields. What of yours? Will gold letters written on a shield with a touch of wit be enough to achieve your victory? By the gods, if Zeus' maiden child Dike were to look on him in his thoughts and deeds, then his boast might prove true. But not when he fled the darkness of the womb, nor as a nursing infant. Not in his adolescence, nor when the first hairs thickened on his cheek, did Dike look on him or acknowledge him. No, I do not think she will stand beside him now to aid him in this destruction against his homeland. Justice would be false to her name should she ally herself with a man so utterly audacious in his plans. Convinced of this, trusting my faith, I will go meet him. Yes, I myself. Who else has a more just claim than I? Prince against prince. Brother against brother. Enemy against enemy. Quickly, my armor, the masking metal to ward off stones and spears.
Balaam, son of Oedipus, do not, like your father, in anger invoke evil. Cadmeans battling Argives, that is enough. There is a rite of purification for such blood. But brother against brother, the death of one by the hand of the other, who is the image of himself, such blood spills pollution, which endures the contamination beyond any cleansing. Time itself cannot atone for that sin.
If one must endure the worst, let him endure it with no shame. It is the only thing that is praised by the dead. The worst accompanied by shame that wins no words of praise.
Why so eager?
Do the waves of lust lap against your foot?
Cast off this perilous fascination before it becomes a flood.
It is too late. The gods have declared this event must happen. They quicken its pace. Let the whole race of Laius be doomed. It has earned Apollo's hate. Let him take it to the river of wailing.
How bloodthirsty your urge to commit the slaughter.
Its fruit will be bitter.
The murder of a brother is a sacrilege.
Bloodthirsty indeed! My father's black and bitter curse hovers before my eyes. My dry, unweeping eyes, and speaks, strike now, kill him. Kill him, then be killed. It urges me to grab honor before I die.
Do not listen. Stand firm against that urge.
No one calls the wise man a coward.
The black-robed fury will vanish out of your house when the gods receive sacrifice from your hand.
The gods, it would seem, have banished us from their care. Though they do admire the grace we offer when we perish. Why, then, should I fawn and flinch away from doom?
come upon you with gentle breath.
Temper the blast that now blows, wild and rude and seething.
Seething? It has seethed over. Yes, kindled by Oedipus' dark curse. Too true were the nightly phantoms, my dreams predicting the division of our father's wealth.
I know you don't want to, but listen. Though you dislike our gender, listen to these women.
Then say something useful and don't waste my time.
Good on journey to the seventh gate.
My purpose is finally home. Words will not change my mind.
Any victory, even a cowardly one, is honored by the gods.
Blasphemy! No soldier, no citizen would tolerate such words.
So for victory, you would harvest your own brother's blood.
There is no escape from the will of the immortal gods. When the gods give evil, there is no escape from their will.
Yeah.
the battering of many waves, we solid stand. And the ship of state sails beneath serene sky. The walls hold. We have fortified the gates with champions, fully capable in single-handed combat. Things go well, for the most part, at six gates. But the seventh, awesome Apollo took, captain of seven, on Oedipus's house, he has fully prepared for our victory.
What further news do you have of our town?
Our town? It's safe. But the sons are slain by each other's hands. Control yourselves! Just be calm and listen. Hear now, the sons of Oedipus.
Oh, what misery! I am prophet to these evils.
I tell you plainly, struck down in the dust.
They went so far. Are they lying out there? Tell me fully.
The brothers are dead. One, the others killed.
Did brothers' hands achieve a mutual murder?
Have done with questions. The earth has quenched its thirst with their blood.
Oh, so much akin the destiny took them. And in the selfsame hour.
Yes. Too much akin in their destiny. It has consumed the ill-starred lineage. Now, mix your exultation with your tears. Our city fares well, while the leaders, the two princes, with forged Scythian steel, have made full division of their fatherland. And, as their father's imprecation bear, will have their due of land, a twofold grave. So, is our city saved. The earth has drank the blood of twin princes, each by the other slain.
Zeus,
God who protect our city,
you have indeed saved the towers of Cadmus. Tell me what to do now.
Should I be glad now?
Should I shout with triumphant joy? Or should I shed bitter tears?
Eteocles, truly notorious,
and Polynices, the source of much strife.
Oh, lack conclusive prayer of Laius' race, Oedipal curse, oh dark, an evil
pierced through your left sides. Pierced indeed, through those sides that were born of one womb.
Suffered.
Wretched family
that must severely suffer. heart-grumming cares. Mourners of light name, throughout three generations, in the blood of grief.
Aye.
Destiny, grievous bestower of heavy ills. Oh, awesome shade of Oedipus, black spirit of vengeance, how mighty is your power.
Aye.
Now you know the fury. Having experienced her terror, you learn her ways, and you are made aware no later than he. A city, as a rival oarsman to his sword, helpless to speak, helpless to see, a tale of destruction as far as the eye can see.
Alas for suffering,
alas for evil,
for home and land,
above all for me, and no less for me. I pity your grievous sufferings, my king.
Pity for you both, most lamentable of all men.
You were possessed by delusion.
I pity your grievous suffering, Polynices, my lord.
Lord of groaning evils, Eteocles, my ruler.
Where should we lay them in the earth?
Where their honor is most greatest.
Lie beside their father. Let their father feel their pain. Aye!
To report the will and decision of the High Council of Cadmus City. Eteocles here, loyal to his land and city, will be buried in the earth he so loved. Fighting our enemies, he found his death here, inside of his ancestral shrine. He chose to stand and fight. He is pure and blameless. He died what is noble for the young. With formality, grandeur, and regal procession, Eteocles will be given a state honor with funeral. As for Polynices, or rather his dead body, you must cast out unburied for the dogs to drag and tear, as befits one who had ruined his country. Had not some god used his brother's spear to prevent him? Even in death, he is stained with dishonor against his ancestral shrine by bringing his mongrel horde to invade and sack the city. Leave the wide-winged birds to bury him, a just reward for him. May no earth scatter over his body. No womanly wails may you moan in voice. No funeral or memorial may be held in honor by his friends. So it has been decreed by the Cadmean Council.
What Cadmean Council? Who makes claim to rule? Hold them. They stand in authority, that I will bury this man, even if no one else is willing to bury him. I will bury Polynices, facing the risk involved. He is my brother. I feel no shame in defying lawless authority. Deep in my heart is set my sisterhood. Strange. Strange thing is the common blood from which we sprang. A mother wretched, a father doomed to evil. So I who live will share with the dead one grief unwanted, showing a sister's love. I will be a true sister to a brother dead. As long as I live, I will defy this outrage. No dogs, no birds, nor even the hungry-bellied wolves will feast upon his flesh. None can decree me. Earth to bury. I myself, a mere woman, will bring. With golden linen robes, I will cover him. No one can decree me. No. I will cover him. Let no man command otherwise. This will be done. A way will be found. My sister's heart will not fail me in this.
You are forbidden to violate the decrees of the council.
You are forbidden to make useless proclamations at me.
The people say from a city of ruin can be hostile.
True. But this man will not lie unburied.
What? You think your city's enemy deserves a tomb?
The gods decided what he deserves.
a long time ago.
No. Not before he attacked an entire city.
He received evil, so he repaid evil with evil.
But he attacked this entire city to avenge one man.
Arguments can go on forever. Even amongst the gods, discord wants the last word.
Be self-willed, then. But the council forbids burial.
I will bury him. Waste no more words.
What must I feel? Or do? What course must I take? How can I refuse to bewail you, or refuse an escort to your tomb? But I fear and shrink in terror at the city's power.
You will at least find many mourners, but this one, hapless and unlamented, has only his sister's wails to escort him to his tomb. Who can approve of that?
Even if the city punishes those who mourn Polynices, I will escort his body with proper grief and help bury him. For this grief is shared by our whole race, and as I know, the city favors different things at different times.
I will go with the Teocles, as the city and justice approves. Next to the blessed ones, mighty, powerful Zeus. This man saved the Cadmean city. It did not capsize under the flood of foreign foe, overwhelmed in utter disaster.
Oh, ray of sunshine! Most beautiful that ever shone on the city of the Seven Gates. Seven men match seven warriors. Gave Zeus their final tribute. All but that pair of wretched men, born of one father and one mother too, who set their swords against each other and died a common death. Generations of men are like the leaves. In winter, the winds blow them down to earth. Ah, you fury! Now you can boast, you evil spirit of vengeance, you ruin of the house who has brought down the